Hello and welcome to this video about DR Advisor, which is a data-driven demand response recommender system tool being developed at the University of Pennsylvania. My name is Madhur Behal. I'm a PhD student at the Real-Time and Embedded Systems Lab in Electrical and Systems Engineering, where I work with my advisor, Professor Rahul Mangaram. But before we delve into what DR Advisor is all about and how it can address challenges of demand response, I thought it's best to start with a story about tea time in Britain. So in Britain, there's a show called EastEnders, which is being broadcasted by the BBC for the last few decades. But every evening when that show airs, the folks at the National Electricity Grid Center, they are very anxious. They brace themselves, in fact, for the most anxious part of their day. The reason is that as soon as the credits start to roll, because it's Britain, about 1.5 to 2 million electric kettles are switched on near simultaneously across the electricity grid. And that leads to a huge surge in the electricity consumption and may lead up to a spike of as large as 3 gigawatts. That's 3 billion watts. And if there is not enough electricity in the grid to meet this demand, the frequency of electricity will begin to fall from 50 hertz to 49.9 to 0.8. If it falls too low, then they run a risk of a blackout or a brownout across major parts of their country. So just in order to mitigate this peak and meet this huge surge, they have to ramp up generators from Iceland and Snowdonia, sometimes even borrow electricity from France. I would say a similar event also occurs here in the United States. While we don't drink as much tea here, but take for instance a major sporting event like the Super Bowl. With more than 100 million viewers watching such an event, whenever there's a commercial or a halftime show, people are quite likely to open up a refrigerator to grab a drink or heat up something in their microwaves. But when millions of people do the same action almost simultaneously, it can lead to a massive TV pickup surge on the grid. The same phenomena also occurs at our own campus. So this is an overview of the campus of the University of Pennsylvania. It has about more than 100 buildings. And on a very hot summer day, every building is trying to cool itself, consume electricity, regardless of what the other building is doing. And therefore, it can lead to a huge peak in the overall power consumption of the building. And we can see that if we look at the power consumption plotted from the last few years. So this plot shows the Penn's electricity demand from 2011. And there are two things of note here. The first is the total bill is quite high. Of course, the campus is quite large, but still it costs $28 million to supply electricity to the entire campus over a year. But more importantly, if we just look at the top 5 days, the top 5 most expensive days, they cost more than $1.5 million, which is about 6% of the bill. And part of the reason why this number is so high is because the price of electricity itself changes for a large-scale commercial customer like University of Pennsylvania. The nominal price may be about $30 per megawatt hour, but on a hot day, it can ramp up 27x to go more than $800 per megawatt hour. So we now understand that both human behavior and extreme weather like polar vortices or heat waves are responsible for causing these huge spikes on the electricity grid. And in order to provide enough electricity to meet these surges, the generation has to use inefficient and old expensive peaker plants. They are usually not used, but whenever the demand is high, they have to rely on this old and inefficient technology, which is why it's also very expensive to provide electricity. So in fact, in the generation side, there's a saying that all kilowatts are not created equally, and you can sort of see that here with some data from the PJM ISO, that as the load changes during the day, the price of electricity also changes because you are going to more inefficient and more older sources for meeting that electricity demand. So an alternative to using this expensive and inefficient and dirty energy is what is called demand response. And it's generally agreed that demand response is much more reliable and a cost-effective way of meeting these peak demands. In fact, if we go back to some PJM data again, we can see that In the recent years, demand response has surpassed renewable energy sources in the PJM installed megawatt capacity, and it is expected that it will continue to rise for the next few years. So what is demand response? A simple idea is that from the generation's perspective, they see that the electricity load has increased on the grid, and they anticipate that there's going to be a peak event that may be due to the EastEnders show or the Super Bowl or just because it's too hot outside. So they anticipate there's a peak, and at this point in time, they dispatch what is called a demand response request to the end users. And these end users are large-scale customers like industries or shopping centers, universities, or even apartment buildings. And these end users, in turn, have to take some action to shed their non-critical load and reduce their power consumption so that when you aggregate this curtailment, the peak is avoided. And because these users participated in this demand response event and provided reliability at the cost of shedding their load, they are financially rewarded for doing the same. This is a very high-level model, but that's the premise of demand response. And you can see there's an economic incentive for the end users to curtail during peaks. So here's an example of such an event at Penn. Penn is a load-serving entity, which means it buys electricity from the real-time electricity market. So whenever they anticipate that there's going to be a red day or a very expensive day, the faculty get notified that we are going to have rolling shutdowns because of energy conservation and cost-saving measures, and they then also point out that the price of electricity has increased quite a bit. So my focus, or the focus of this research, is towards end-user demand response, where we are trying to answer a very basic question that upon receiving a demand response request, what does the user do? What action does he take, and how to figure out what's the best action to take? So remember, well, he's required to sustain a curtailed response during the duration of the event. And really the name of the game is that how low can you go with your demand before it becomes very inconvenient for you? So the key to answering this question lies in predicting the electricity consumption of a building or of a campus, for instance. In particular, the challenge with demand response, end user demand response, is twofold. The first is we would like to predict what is called the baseline electricity consumption. We want to predict the electricity consumption of a building when there is no demand response event. The reason why we want to predict this baseline is important because any curtailment can only be measured with respect to a baseline. If we don't know what we would have consumed, then we cannot even measure how much we actually curtailed. So it's very critical to get good estimates of the baseline. In fact, it's very important even from a financial standpoint because any payment that you get as a result of your curtailment will also depend upon how accurately you measure the baseline. So there are some very simple methods in place which usually rely on just averaging your past load. But I want to emphasize here that's one of the challenges to get accurate measurements of the baseline. The second prediction that we want is not for the baseline, but the actual profile of the building itself when we take some action. So we might have switched off some equipment or changed a few set points. If we can predict what the building's energy consumption will be due to our changes, then that would be useful in order to plan or figure out good strategies for end users. So let's look at an example here. Suppose we have a fixed demand response strategy where, based on our knowledge of the building or experience, we figured out what set points to tweak with or what appliances to switch off during a notification. But there could be multiple such strategies. So we could have strategy A or B. So we can have 5 to 10 or maybe even more number of strategies, but we can only act once, right? We can only choose one of them and go forth. So how do we decide what we choose? Well, if we could predict the power consumption of the building based on a fixed strategy, then we can choose the best strategy at every time step. And you can see that if we had the ability to predict, then we can even readjust our strategy as the event moves along. So, of course, this problem has been known for quite some time. Demand response has been around for quite some time. And in general, I would say there are three basic approaches that people use to address the problem of end user DR. The majority of these approaches are rule-based, and put simply, that they are recommended guidelines and best practices that are put into place as to suggest, based on experience or some very limited testing, as to what actions should you take when you get a notification. Or people usually measure how much do they stand to save if they switch off some major equipment in their buildings. The other extreme is what is called model-based demand response, in which the approach is that we will mathematically model very in high fidelity the entire dynamical behavior of our building and take into account what is the weather outside. And based on our model and what this model predicts, we will take good actions. Lately and recently, has been some interest in data-driven demand response, but moving forward, I think data-driven will be the way to address DR problems, especially because modeling very large and complex systems takes a lot of effort, as we'll see shortly. So as I said earlier, rule-based DR is really very simple, and you can see here how simple it is. This is an example of some recommended guidelines for demand response from Siemens, and they are just plain text English guidelines. They don't really tell you exactly what to do, but they tell you some rules of thumb that if you do this based on how much notification time you have or what's the duration of the event, then prioritize these actions. And this is a good strategy. It is just that it doesn't take any feedback of what the building is actually doing, or it doesn't take into account what's the temperature outside. So in a sense, it doesn't have any predictive capability. It's only reactive. And an example would be that the plot on the top right shows that you have a baseline consumption. If you use some rule, then you can shed some load that you aren't really sure about, so you cannot predict in advance. And if you use another rule, you might shed more, but then it might lead to a secondary peak or a kickback, as they call it, later on after the event has stopped. And we don't have to look far to see this in practice. I'm based in Philadelphia, so in our own city, we have these two big buildings called Liberty Property Trust buildings. And back in 2002, we got some data from them to see how they were planning their demand response. They might have evolved since then, but back then, their approach was rule-based demand response. And you can see that kind of in this summary of their DR testing. You have different rolling levels of DR curtailment, in which they are specific rules for HVAC and lighting, but they are fixed rules. It's not based on some kind of a model of a building. So talking about models, the other extreme is also an example from the city of Philadelphia. This building called Building 101 is in the Navy Yard. It served as the headquarters of the DOE Energy Efficient Buildings effort. And one of the approaches, not specifically targeted at demand response in particularly, but a general approach, was to model this building. And that process took more than 6 months, a lot of domain expertise. So it's a very cost and time prohibitive effort to build such models. You have to measure a lot of things from the building in order to get accurate models and tune them. And on the top of that, you build an envelope model, the thermal model of the building, and separately you have to model the equipment and the all the HVAC devices in the building itself. And it's fine to do it for one building, especially because this was a research effort, so it made sense to do that. But it's kind of hard to imagine how this would scale up to, say, a campus. And that's really the level at which we want to operate. So it's very infeasible to model every building on a campus with that detail. So with that in mind, we turn to data-driven demand response. And really the goal there is that, can we get the best of both worlds? Can we keep the simplicity of rule-based DR, which everybody in the industry likes? Things have to be simple and very intuitive, while at the same time have some predictive capability of model-based demand response. And our solution is data-driven, and it's called DR Advisor, or Demand Response Advisor. And you can think of this tool as shown here as an oscilloscope. It's an oscilloscope for a building. It's looking at different signals and different channels from the building, whatever it can observe, looking at weather data from outside of the building, and then churning those numbers, crunching them, and trying to make recommendations on what actions to take during a demand response event. In particular, it uses a technique called regression trees and machine learning to build such a recommender system. And many of you might be already familiar with regression trees, but just so that we are on the same page, I'll first give a very high level and a fast crash course on what our regression trees are. So we all know what a tree looks like. In order to imagine a regression tree, it's useful to visualize an upside down tree with something called the root node at the top of the tree, which branches out into other nodes based on some splitting criteria, which we'll define later. And if you split these nodes further on, you can recursively partition it into more and more nodes until you reach the bottom of the tree where you have leaf nodes, which correspond to the possible outcome or the prediction of this model, if you will. And it becomes very clear with a very trivial example. Suppose we want to predict whether a person likes the movie The Usual Suspects. I think it's a great movie, so a person should probably like it. But how could we make this prediction for a particular person? Well, let's use the idea of trees. If we have historical data on what movies the person has seen and whether he liked them or not, we can imagine a tree where the node itself is the movie or some attribute of the movie, whether it was a thriller or a comedy. And the splitting criteria is whether that person liked the movie or not. Now, I'm not sure what kind of a person will not like The Godfather, but given that we have enough historical data about what movies the person has watched, down at the bottom in the leaves, we can get some kind of prediction as to what we think the person's reaction will be on watching The Usual Suspects. And once you understand this very simple idea, it's not hard to imagine how you could use such a system to make recommendations. And by no means am I claiming that Netflix uses this algorithm. It's just to show that whatever they use is very close in spirit to what I described here. So that's good. We understand now how trees work and how we can use them to make predictions. So they are kind of a predictive model. But now we want to ask the question, can we use this regression tree-based approach or modify it and apply it to a demand response challenge where we also want to predict not movies, but the power consumption of the building. So the way we do it is, first let's look at what data do we need. We obviously need weather data, historical weather information, mostly concerned with temperature, humidity. Sometimes solar information is also available that can be easily incorporated into the tool. But we need weather data, and I want to point out that weather data is almost zero sensor cost these days. You can obtain weather data for the previous years or for the present day from third-party websites online by paying them a fee, but you don't need sensors installed at your own building to measure all the weather information. So it's zero sensor cost. We need weather data. We also need some schedule data, and this is also zero cost because schedule data involves measuring the time of day or the day of week. Well, I don't need a sensor to tell me what time of day it is. I need a clock. And then you can also use some set point schedule information. This is different from saying that you are reading the set point from, say, a thermostat in the building. What set point schedule implies here is that there's some fixed schedule for the set point in some Excel spreadsheet or some simple text, plain text schedule information available which the building follows. And if that is available, it can be incorporated as one of the features to predict the power consumption in our algorithm. Lastly, if you are trying to predict the power consumption of the building, it's a good idea to measure it. So we need some measurements from the building itself. In particular, we need the power consumption to be measured. But on top of that, if we want to figure out what's the effect on the power consumption as we turn these control knobs of set points and lighting, then we also need information about the chilled water temperature and zone temperature previously. So with these things in mind and the regression tree approach, here's an example of what the tree looks like. This tree was obtained from a 12-story office building data, a year's worth of data with more than 3 million data points. And although it looks quite intimidating, it's actually very, very simple. And at every node in the tree is a simple decision rule. And this decision rule is of the form that if the temperature outside is below a particular value, then you go to the left branch of the tree. Otherwise, you go to the right branch of the tree. And these are very simple if this then that decision rules, much like our movie example. So although it's a large tree, at every node, the rule is very simple. And this is how well it performs. So remember I spoke about baseline prediction earlier. Here's an example for the same building. We are trying to predict the baseline for July 17th during a demand response event from 5 to 6 in the evening. And you can see the black line here, the solid black line, is the ground truth consumption of the building, whereas the other colored lines are the prediction. The reason why we have multiple predictions is because if you look at the legend of the graph, we are not using a single tree, but using different tree-based approaches to predict the same thing, just trying to figure out which one performs the best. But it performs quite well. You can see it has a 97% accuracy, so very less error rate. And let's look at another demand response example. In this particular case, we have a strategy that I spoke about earlier. So you might have one strategy or multiple strategy to choose from. In this case, we have one particular strategy in which we are changing the zone air temperature and the chilled water temperature during the event within a particular range. And we want to now ask the question that, suppose we wanted to predict what the power consumption of the building would have been had we implemented a strategy, then it would allow us to choose good strategies in the future. And if we use our tree-based toolbox approach, then the error is a little bit more than 3%, but still very reasonable and very acceptable. We just have a 6% error. Again, some models predict the response quite well. They track it quite well. Some other models have a slightly higher error. But I want you to also pay attention to the y-axis here. It's in the order of megawatts. So you are experiencing a 5 to 6% error on something which is on the order of megawatts, so you're still doing reasonably well. So another way we wanted to validate and benchmark our methods was to train it on publicly available data set. So this is something called the ASTRA Great Energy Predictor Shootout, which was held in the early 90s. And the idea was that ASTRA invited the research community by making a data set available to them and inviting them to learn data-driven models on that data set. In particular, what they had provided was 4 months of training data in which you had to train on these four weather features and then predict not just the electricity consumption, but two more attributes of the building for 2 months of testing data that you had never seen before. So it's a hard problem because you are training on 4 months which are similar but still different from your testing period. And on top of that, you are not just trying to predict electricity, but also chilled and hot water consumption only based on these four features, plus some schedule or time of day information that you might introduce yourself. So we use this data set and evaluate how well we perform. And of course, the benefit of doing that is we can compare our performance to the winners of that competition. And it turns out that we outperform everybody except one team. So we are second among more than 100 participating teams. If you are curious, the winner of the competition was using something called neural networks, artificial neural networks. So he somehow managed to figure out the correct weights and introduce some really good training measures to outperform everyone else. But that's not the point here. The point is that DR Advisor is a good tool, and it validates that it's a good litmus test that we can do well on real world data and compared to other approaches as well. So at the underneath the hood in the toolbox, the idea is quite straightforward. We have historical data, which is available, and the data sets that I described before. And you use that data to not train one tree, but we want to build a family of regression trees. So there might be a tree suitable for just baselining, some other tree suitable for evaluating demand response strategies based on different horizons as well. So we want to use this family of trees to address the challenges of demand response that I spoke about earlier. The holy grail vision is that DR Advisor as a tool will run as a service. So you can imagine this as a service which is pulling data from a campus, from commercial buildings, and running these regression tree approaches to build these predictive models. And because it is a service, I imagine it will have two different kinds of clients. It will have end users as clients, which are large commercial entities, including our own university. Plus, I also think it's a useful tool for the service providers or the utility companies, and they can also leverage the service as a client. The end users can, of course, use this toolbox for better response, which is the goal, on what they do when they get a DR notification. But the service providers like Enernoc or ComEdison, Veridity, they can use this information for better dispatch. So they can figure out how much should we ask a particular large scale customer to curtail, given that we have some idea of what's the conditions under which we are asking that particular customer to curtail. So a quick word on why we use regression trees, because clearly, you know, we've seen in one example at least that neural networks can do quite well. The advantages are listed here. Some of them are common with any data-driven method, and particularly, you know, most methods are very fast and computationally as well as in terms of the memory they require. But some are unique to regression trees. So regression trees in particular can handle a lot of missing data, and it can handle outliers quite well compared to other approaches. And that's just by design, the way they work. It can, of course, handle a mix of categorical and continuous variables, and it doesn't matter how many variables you have. They don't have to be linearly independent, so all those assumptions do not matter for trees because it is a non-parametric statistical method, not making any assumption about distributions. Another point, which is not a technical point but nonetheless very important, is that trees are very, very easily interpretable. And what I mean by that is there's a lot of inertia in the building's community where you can make a fancy optimization, which is trying to figure out what to do, but if the facilities manager does not understand or does not trust the system, then it's almost of no use. And this is something I've experienced myself as we were doing research in the past few years. I spent time with a control systems company working on their chiller optimization system, and one of the problems there was that we wanted to make the optimization more understandable, more interpretable. In fact, interpretability of machine learning algorithms has now become an active area of research, so no longer can you ignore this aspect. And by design, regression trees, as we see, are just simple rules of English, very human readable, so anybody can understand what's going on and how this prediction is being obtained. Another reason for using trees, or I would say another application in the toolbox, is that once you've learned a tree, you can actually use it for more than just prediction. You can run some filters on top of a tree. But what I mean is, let's for instance say the facilities manager wants to know under what circumstances does my building consume a particular energy level. What that translates in the tree language is we prune the tree to a single branch where the prediction is 750 kilowatts. So in doing so, we will let him know what rules or what circumstances have to occur under which the building consumes 750 kilowatts. Likewise, we can ask questions as, are there any rare events in my tree? By a rare event, we mean an event which occurs very less frequently. So the leaves at that particular branch are very few. But whenever it occurs with high confidence. And this kind of an approach could be interesting just to figure out some nuances of the building. Or if pursued correctly, it can be also useful for fault detection and diagnostics. So just a word before I conclude that this is a big ongoing project at University of Pennsylvania, and we collaborate in our own university and outside. There is contract negotiation, demand response, pricing involved. So we work with faculty from statistics and operations research at Penn. Then we also work with both building designers and policymakers from the School of Design. On occasion, we work quite closely with Penn facilities who provide us data of different buildings on our own campus and help us better understand how this large-scale system works. It's very impressive. Then we've also collaborated with universities in Europe and a part of a big collaboration led by University of Berkeley. So I would end here and encourage you to contact me by email if you are interested in knowing more about this toolbox and would like to try out a demo or work with it. So thank you for watching this video.